My friends, I'm not given to wild, unsupported statements. And I tell you that we must evacuate this planet immediately.
Jor-El, be reasonable.
Hello, everybody. My name is Jay.
And I'm Sam.
And welcome back to Movie Bluffs, where we're going through the entire filmography of the DC Universe. Everything that was released theatrically, chronological order, we're just going right through them. And today, we're going to be doing Superman 1, 78.
Yes. Oh, Superman 1. The one that started it all. And I have questions.
Lots of questions. I'm like, okay. little nitpicks, but you know, it's fine. All right, so for this one, why don't you recap for us?
Okay, let's see. All right, let me crank back my memory banks and let's see if I can do this. Okay, so if I remember correctly, the story is being told through kids, through retelling of the story of Superman.
Like a comic from the 30s.
So of Superman. And we start off from the very beginning in Krypton, where, if I remember correctly, where Jor-El, starring Marlon Brando, warns the entire race of Krypton in the planet that the planet's going to be destroyed. Of course, everybody doesn't believe him, even though he has proof and science and all that stuff. It's like, we believe you, but no.
Yes, your science is dumb and gay, so.
Yeah, so no. And also, if you tell everybody, insurrection, so, and that'll be treason. So I was like, what? Oh, sure. And like, Marlon Brando, I'm calling him Marlon Brando. Let's say Marlon Brando was like, okay. I was like, so time later, Marlon Brando's had a secret plan to send his son, was it Kal-El, which is Clark, up to space, which he did. And also in the meantime, the whole planet gets destroyed, Death Star style.
Also, I just want to say, it's like 2 minutes of just people just dying horribly.
Yes. Oh my gosh. Oh, and I forgot.
In beautiful CinemaScope. It's like blaring red and reflective tinfoil. It was really nice.
Yes. And all the people who were like, come on, Jura, come on, Marlon Brando, this is all wrong. They all die.
they're all dead.
So they all get so the whole planet gets destroyed, and then Clark, who's in the space pod, is going straight to Earth, being taught by his dad, Marlon Brando, and then lands into Smallville, where he meets the Kents, where he gets adopted, and then his dad dies, and then he has to go off to a journey up north, which he somehow goes up to the North Pole, throws a jewel that he found
it's a psychic crystal that for some reason waited until Pa Kent died, and then it implanted like bird migratory patterns. It implanted in him the need to go north and plant his crystal.
Pretty much. His crystal seed. Okay. Yes. Which he did, and they became the Fortress of Solitude. Okay. Then, yes. after Marlon Brando teaches Clark how to be Superman, he became Superman. And then Clark becomes an everyday reporter, and he runs into Lois. And then, all of a sudden, if I remember correctly, Lois was just going to meet the president. And then, all of a sudden, she was in a helicopter. And then, there was an accident. And then, an accident happened. She was about to fall. And she was going to fall. And then, what's here? Superman comes in and saves her. And that's not all. He comes and continues you on a montage of saving the day. Meanwhile, there's a police, a couple of cops are chasing this guy named Otis, who's going after Lex Luthor. And Lex Luthor has some kind of master plan.
Also, I just want to say I'm very proud that you remembered Otis's name.
Yes, it's because of Otisburg. It's just Otisburg. That's why I remember that name. It's because it's Otisburg. It's a good joke. So that was his plan. And then all of a sudden he hears about Superman. Meanwhile, the news wants to know who is Superman and how would they get it? How would they know? And of course, fortunately, Superman chooses Lois. Okay, and after a nice romantic evening, I would say, of an interview, they got the scoop of what we know about Superman, about his powers and everything. And it's okay.
He just tells a reporter all of his powers, all of his strengths, his weaknesses. I'm sorry, go on.
Yeah, right. I know there's a lot to explain there. So Lex noticed the news. He figured, I realize we can find a weakness for this guy and we can do our plan, which we still don't know what he's doing. All we know is that he somehow does some coordination on a nuke, and apparently, and a coordination on a nuke. So later on, we figured, and then that's the part where I'm starting to get lost.
So literally, Lex Luthor sends out a supersonic message that only Superman and dogs can hear. And it's like, hey, Superman, I've planted bombs all over the city in random places. And if you don't come to stop me, I'm gonna do stuff.
Now I remember. Thank you. That was the part I don't remember. Okay. Yeah. Yes. After the supersonic message that only Superman can hear, he finds Lex and then he tries to get. And then he's like, where's the bomb, Lex? Oh, my bomb. Oh, you mean my two nukes that he launches as he said it? Okay. Mm-hmm. And then I was like, okay, where's the thing? Oh, I mean, you can't stop both of them, even though you're fast, super fast, and you can travel back in time. You can't travel back in time and stuff. It's like, so he told them where's the he tried to, like, find where's the device. And then surprise trap, kryptonite. And then he just, like, wraps around him his neck. And
very loosely,
and just put him in the pool, and then he launches, like, while the two nukes are gonna be launched. Before he launched the nukes, he did monologue his plan. What is his plan? To hit a nuke into San Andreas Fault to sneak California, so all the land he bought will be premium beachfront property. That's
millions of people dead.
Yes,
property costs increase.
Yes, exactly.
Money.
Yes. So that was his. So, and but he knew that Superman would stop that plan. So his other plan was to send another nuke, which was supposedly at his girlfriend's, Miss Chuckmecker's, mom's house.
Yeah.
Which is so dumb. Like, okay. Either way.
Like, how did you not know?
Either way, Superman was struggling, but was rescued by Miss Chuckmecker. Rescue Chessbacker, but promised to save her her mom's home city, which he did. So he did save
a little sexual assault.
Yes. Oh yeah, yes. I forgot about that. Yes. So Superman did. He diverted a nuke and he stopped a nuke, but he did not stop the other nuke. So the earthquakes and everything was being destroyed. But Superman, being Superman, was able to stop everything. However, in the meantime, during that whole disaster, Jimmy and Lois were there. Jimmy was about to be taken care of, but he was saved. But he was not able to save Lois in time, and Lois dies. Not accepting this, Superman did the only thing he could do by spinning the world so fast that the planet, that the somehow orbit goes backwards, and somehow everything, time travels got backwards, and now Lois is fine. Somehow he gets Lex Luthor off screen, puts him to jail, and a day is saved. Da da da. Yes. And there's a lot to talk. I have a lot of questions about that fucking turnaround, that time travel shit.
We will get to that, but let's concentrate on good.
Yeah. Okay, so. Okay,
I mean, I can start.
Yeah, go for it. I mean, there's a lot I like about it, but you go start. Yeah, you go start.
So, I mean, like, one of the things that I really liked about this, just, like, I was scrubbing through it earlier, like, in preparation for this episode, And I just really like the way it looks, like just the way it's shot. A lot of things are just like kind of glowy and dreamy. There's like maybe like a shitty fog machine like off the side of the stage, and it's just throwing enough fog to like make it look a bit dreamlike.
I agree with you, because I do like that, like a good way. One of the few things I did like about how it looked was how the Kryptonians look like. Their clothes were literally vibrating, and they looked like they were divine in a way, and even though they're just alien species.
Right. I found out that's the same material that they used for like the original lightsaber effect, like the light glow that they got on the original effect.
Oh, really? That explains a lot.
I'll see if I can find it. I'll put it in.
Yeah, do that. Like, but that's actually interesting if it is, because I mean, obviously we know what the lightsaber looks like now. And it clearly that image that we see now was an evolution, because I know, because like, try to see old Star Wars. Old Star Wars without the fucking new editing. You will easily tell. I don't know where you can find it, but I saw it once when I was younger, right before when the whole remaster shit became a thing. But I don't know if you can, I mean, online, like find like I mean, people who are listening.
Yeah, I'm sure you can probably find it on YouTube somewhere.
You could find it somewhere. I mean, if not, you can find like at least a shot of
images.
old images of old lightsaber, because like you can easily tell because it doesn't look like that, but it does give a good feel of that glow. Again, that glow, it just works. It pops out a lot, but it works because it sounds what they're telling.
Also, you know? I just like how glowy and reflective it is, but it isn't. It doesn't like cast, I guess, actual light, so it doesn't make like a whole bunch of shadows everywhere. You can still make out everyone's faces. You can still make out everyone's details, and it's just like this weird ethereal brightness.
I feel like that's like a bit of like a product of that time, because I don't see that shot ever like look like that ever again in modern stuff too.
No.
It's like I feel like it's just a camera. Like it can only cast it like
Man
that.
Of Steel.
Oh, they would. I mean, why not? I mean, there's a lot. I mean, well, we'll go talk more about Man of Steel when we get there, and also when we talk about number two, because there's a lot of comparisons between this with Man of Steel, with this movie, and with number one and two. Like number one, it's like number one and two feels like Man of Steel, but not good. But okay, we'll go back to we'll talk about that when we get there. So what I did like about it was the actors. Like I think Marlon Brando, Marlon Brando nailed it. Even though now that I know what he did behind the screens. We should go into that,
we're gonna do a Brando episode.
he knocked it out of the park. Lex, I mean Gene Hackman as Lex was so fucking great. Like I loved him. Like despite that, how much I want to complain about Lex right now, he pulled it off. He was a good arch villain. And I liked it.
I would say he was a very good cartoon villain.
Yes, I will give him that. That's what I liked about it.
Because, like, as much as I like Gene Hackman, he does show up on my list of bad things. Because he's not Lex Luthor. He's just a cartoon villain, and he's doing a good job, but he's not Lex Luthor.
I'm having fun with him, though. And that's what I... Don't get me wrong, I have complaints, too, but, like, and you'll get to them, too, but I had fun with them. But I would say most of the actors did it right. Come on.
Yeah, for me, casting... phenomenal. Like, yes, apparently, yes. This is like one of Margot Kidder's, the woman who played Lois Lane. This is one of her first roles.
Oh, really? Out of the park, seriously. Like, I can't, like, Lois, right? like, I cannot, you could not find a better, like, you could not find, like, the better Lois, seriously. You did it right. Like, you did, like, you did it right. Like, did any of the other Superman movies after that did a pretty good Lois, because everybody still complains about Man of Steel Lois. That's debatable. I'm not saying she's a bad, but debatable. Debatable. There was also the other Lois from Superman Returns. Nobody talks about that, so take that from what you will. But so I think what I'm trying to get across is that I don't think anybody pulled it off as good as she has.
Also, Christopher Reeve, really good. Also, relatively unknown.
Yes, if I'm right, this was his breakout role, right? Wasn't it?
Yeah, this is also his breakout role.
Yeah, really. I mean, come on, he pulled it off. I mean, he was great.
Oh my god, there's so much charm, so much charisma, and he pulls off both Clark and Superman. It's great.
I like that Christopher Reeve. Yeah, Christopher Reeve pulled off the one thing about the whole, like the glasses debate. You know, like, mm-hmm. You know the classic glasses debate? It's like, what's with the glasses? Like, no. There's more to this than just the glasses.
Right. It's posture, it's his hair, it's the way he speaks.
Exactly. And Christopher Reeve, just exactly when he needs to be the incompetent nerd, and then exactly when he needs to be the hero. And it works. It really shows. The good example is when he acts towards Lois as Clark and then as Superman. And the difference is it's just right. It's just there. And it's like, and it's still the same guy. But it doesn't, and you know it's the same guy. He looks like the same guy, but he doesn't feel like the same guy.
Right. Like I do believe all the things that would fool people. It's the only thing is that he's still like 6'4" and incredibly handsome.
Yeah, right. That's the thing. Like, I look at this like, Clark, you're not a nerd. You look pretty good. The glasses are actually kind of helping.
I think that's just like the weirdest persona to pick when you're the size of like an 800-pound gorilla.
What really got me was with the chemistry between Lois and Clark, and those two that's the thing that got me mostly. That's what I think was the main seller with this movie, and
it's like it's just kind of wild that you have like two kind of unknown actors just kind of pop in, nail the roles, have great chemistry. Like, I don't know, you just don't see that anymore.
That's actually very true. These two. Their first time, their first try, knocked it out of the park in their first try. Okay, like, that is almost, that's very hard. That's like star alignment shit. Okay?
Yeah, like, because in modern comic book movies, sometimes, like, the hero and their love interest have, like, no chemistry, at all.
I'm trying to think of any Marvel ones, and the only one I could think of is Tony and Pepper, and they're okay.
I like their dynamic, especially in the first movie. It kind of gets annoying later.
That's the thing, though. I wish there was more, and we don't get more. We just get that first movie, and that's why I'm saying it's okay, because it doesn't keep going.
I'm pretty
sure
it's because like no one wanted to work with Gwyneth Paltrow. It's like, oh, fuck this again.
I totally agree, because like ever since the whole Goop thing, you know, yeah, she's trying
to sell Goop to all of her castmates.
I bet you it's like no, we don't
want
to buy Goop.
Are you sure you don't want my vagina candle?
You mean the vagina egg? You mean the vagina jade egg?
No, there's also a vagina candle. It's scented like her vagina.
What the hell?
By Goop. My god.
I noticed that Marvel never got their romances really right, except for probably maybe with Captain America with Captain Carter, but again, one movie.
One movie.
And not only they get it right the first time, I think it gets pretty bad. I already saw the first two so far, but mm-hmm. I mean, the second one still works with them. It's a little more.
It's a little all over the place.
It's a little all over the place, but I feel like it's not them. It's more the writing, not them.
Yeah, that's not their fault. They're doing a good job in two.
Yes, exactly. They're doing, and that's why that's the thing. Now that you mention it, it's really hard. Again, it's kind of weird that they get it right the first try and they can't recreate that again.
Yeah,
you know, go on. Sorry.
Go ahead.
No. Go on. Sorry.
I was gonna say, like, speaking of chemistry, Lex and his henchmen also have like really good repertoire with each other. I like their dynamic.
Yes, I love Oda. I love
Tessmacher and Oda.
Yes, Miss Tessmacher is amazing. I love her. She's just there being a sex figure. That's all she is.
In a different costume every scene.
Yes.
I think her first one is like the incredibly elaborate and revealing titty costume.
Yes. Like, what
and
type
no
of
one,
like?
No one brings any attention to it.
Nobody says anything.
No, it's just this is what she wears.
It's like this, like half her chest is being revealed, just not showing the parts that you obviously can tell. And it's like, and it's just there. I was like, nobody's saying anything. This is a kid's show. This is a kid movie. Like, oh, I mean, this looks like a kid's movie.
I think this is PG.
Yeah, PG. It's like, I was like, wow. But I mean, yeah, she was very scantily clad at times, but I love her.
That's how you know a woman is evil back then. She dresses provocatively.
I call shenanigans, but yeah, no, you're right. But you are right. You are right, though. But, I call shenanigans about that, but yeah, I love her. I also love when fucking Lex says, like, just yells, "Mesh Tash." Yeah, I like her. I do like their dynamic. It's weird. And if I'm right, Mish Tashmaker is like the one who kind of points out with Lex, like, "What the fuck are you talking about?"
It's like, yeah, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? Do people have to die?
Yeah, right? She says, like, the most common
sense
word.
It really makes me wonder. It's like, why are you here? What are you getting out of this? Is it money?
Money. Every, like, you saw all those clothes that she's wearing. She clearly is getting a lot of that. She wants to wear that wardrobe.
Yeah. I mean, but all she does is, like, hang out in an underground sewer base.
I mean, he has all the money, though. So, like,
maybe she's sending all the money to her mom, who's gonna get blown up.
Oh my gosh! Yes. All right. That's all I got for the good in my head.
Yeah, I was gonna say let's go to bad.
Okay.
Let's talk about the bad things that happen in this movie.
Okay. First of all, can I start with this one?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I would talk about my biggest gripe, but should I talk about, I'm contesting with two things, the pacing or the world or the time travel. Which one do you want me to talk about?
I think we'll do time travel last, because I think it leads into Superman 2, and what I want to talk about is about Superman 2.
Okay. So, the fucking pacing. It is slow as fuck, and I am a very patient man, okay? But God. Yeah, I know. You are not, and I'm, yeah, I know. Okay, and I'm so, and I'm sorry, like, there were several times when I first saw it where I just fell asleep because it was just going on and on and on and on and on.
Yeah, there are, like, rarely movies where I can, like, watch the movie and say, why has this seemed so long? We can cut this. We can cut all of this.
Yes. Oh my gosh. Like the opening scene. Like the opening. First of all, love John. Okay. We could put this part of the good. John Williams. Knock it out of the park. John Williams.
John Williams
amazing.
Is great.
Yes. Amazing. Mm-mm. Right. Yes.
I think. He just slathered his John Williamness just all over the place, though. Like,
oh my
gosh,
it's so John Williams everywhere. Like this is so spacey. So like I was
like,
saying, this is like
scene
five
in the farm where it's just like I think it's like 2 minutes long where it's just kind of slowly zooming in and they're just like on like it's Ma Kent and Clark and they're just looking off into the distance and then just the score is just like going up and up and it's like, oh my god, it's like I get that the shot is beautiful. But you're laying it on so thick. I get it. It's a moment that they're having.
For me, it was like you are five notes away from being Star Wars. Like you are so close to being Star Wars. Like, when he goes to his numbers, like you can tell it's almost there being Star Wars. Don't get me wrong, great, but it's also almost there. But in that sequence, it was just 2 minutes of just credits, and I was like, what is going on? I love John Williams, but what the hell, man?
This is like 12 minutes of credits and John Williams score blasting into your face.
Yes, I was like, while the credits are being zoomed into my face, it's like, shoom, shoom. And it's like, I loved it, but it's like, but at the same time, what? This has been going on for a while. And then we went on for too long for an origin story. We timed it before. Like, we timed this. Like, literally, right, like, from the time when the kid read the book to when the time when Clark finally dons the cape and becomes Superman, it's 45 minutes. Minutes.
Nearly an hour in. He's not even doing anything Superman-y. He just appears.
Exactly.
And that's 45 minutes.
Like, the only thing that he did, like, what Clark did anything Superman-y was, like, show that he, like, when he was a baby, his super strength, and when he was a teenager, a bit of his super speed, which did not look good.
did not age well at all.
And but it's like, and then it's like, so we went through that, and so that's all we saw with his powers, and then we finally see that we go through a lot. Just before he dons the cape. Now the Krypton incident, I mean, you could cut that still. Like, I could cut, like, you can cut like 10 minutes of it.
I feel like in the '70s, going into the '80s, everyone knows who Superman is. This is a problem with, like, just a lot of superhero movies in general. Up until even now, sometimes they just really want to do the origin. I understand it for, like, characters that no one really knows, but there are, like, I think like 5 heroes that we just never need an origin story for ever again. Okay, so one thing that just, like, struck me, and I can't even say, like, this is a problem about, like, that this movie has in specific, because it still pops up in movies in general. It's the main antagonist and protagonist have no personal relationship. They don't even know each other until the movie's almost over.
Yeah. Like,
they don't even naturally run into each other. Lex Luthor has to call Superman to him, and then they have their one confrontation.
Yeah, and if I remember correctly, we also time stamped this one too. We remembered, like, we find out the link between Lois and Lex an hour and a half in.
Yeah. Like, that's when they decide to link both plots. An hour and a half in.
Yeah, an hour and a half in. That's, like, almost unheard of to do that now. Especially with a movie this, and they did it to this movie, which was a very successful movie at the time too. It's still well beloved to this day.
It is well regarded, but it's not very well written. Like, there's no real narrative through line. A lot of things just happen. Characters just kind of bumble into the situations they need to be in. But I think that's on purpose, because they're trying to, like, emulate, like, really loose, breezy children's comics from, like, 30s and the 20s.
I
feel like you could still have, like, a narrative that makes sense.
Yeah, because I would agree. Like, it felt like it was, like, four different... Like, with the origin, it felt like an origin chapter, then the story.
Yeah.
And you could just, like... You can put that, I mean, in my head, it's like, I mean, I know you needed that, but there was an easier way to do this. Like, and maybe the reason why, and I get why you're using a lot of the comics, and maybe that's how the comics were like that, but, and maybe it's probably, because obviously this is one of the first comic book movies that they made. So it's obviously that this was like, this was their first try. To get the pacing right, to get the translation right.
Yeah, so they were trying to make a comic book movie, but they wanted to make it like serious cinema.
Yes, which you can. I feel like you can. And in Superman, I think it's a good choice to do it.
Yeah, I think they should. I think this just needs a couple of story tweaks.
That's why, like, that's why, like, it just needed a couple of tweaks. And here's the thing, like, maybe back then it was good, but it's just not aging well now. Like it's starting to show its age. Let me rephrase that. That's a good way to say it. It's starting to show its age.
Yeah.
And
because well, we're seeing, I also think that, well, not showing its age, but like the hokey nature of it. Like, I think it was supposed to be like old fashioned, even in the 70s when they made it. So that might just be on purpose.
Slow, and then I can mention with another thing I didn't like. About, I mean, speaking with the whole story wise and everything, like the whole plot doesn't like a lot of the plot doesn't make a lot of fucking sense when you think about it. Like Lex's plan makes no fucking sense, dude. Like the plan like his master plan is to blow up literally the West Coast. So it can have beachfront property because it's gonna be worth. You know, who's gonna fucking buy that land now because of what you did? like how the fuck? Like,
right? Who would just like? It's like, oh my god, that tragedy in California. I better get on that retail market.
Yeah, right. That retail. It's like, well, oh my God! Look, we got new beachfront property. Like, it's so, it's dumb. Lex is dumb. First of all, I loved.
Well, yeah, he's King Idiot.
I love Gene Hackman. He's great, but he is not Lex Luthor, Master Genius. He's Gene Hackman, Master Criminal. Master Criminal. That's what he is. It's like...
Yeah, that's another thing. Like, do people know who he is? Because, like, I don't know. He keeps having to introduce himself. People are like, oh, who's this person buying up all this property? He's living underground.
Right? It's like... There's this... And then the fact that how he figures out his plans are so... Like at best, like circumstantial, okay, and then most of the time are dumb, and somehow they all work out. Like the fact that how he figured out kryptonite, like how the fuck do you know that was gonna be there was gonna be, and how the fuck did you just find kryptonite? Like how did, like I we know we saw
yeah,
him
there's
steal
like,
it.
There's yeah, there's like some lines like, oh yeah, he just like stole it off some guy, and yeah. Now he has kryptonite.
How do you know that was gonna work? First of all, like there are so many questions with that, and I know I'm just nitpicking with all of that, but when you think about it, it kind of doesn't make that whole thing doesn't make sense, like that somehow.
Yeah, but that's what I mean by like it's just like a children's comic.
Yeah,
they like if you read. Like really old comic books back then, they kind of work like this because they didn't have like actual writers writing them.
That's true. And okay, so if that's the case, and that's what I was okay with, like in the end I didn't hate it that the plan was like that. I didn't hate that it was so convoluted in the
it's
end.
Just it wasn't important
and it felt very haphazard and more and more like there like his mono like again we, like it was weird because they used it like it felt like okay you use some well it's like they had like a good idea but they just didn't fully execute everything. It felt like a half because when the parts where they worked it worked, like with when Lex monologued about his plan, that was great. I laughed again. Otis, like again, his all his city, Lexington, Lexburg, Chesh, whatever. Otisburg, it's like Otisburg. I that was great. That's some good stuff right there. And that's some classic villain shit too. Like, and that's something that even I know that Lex would probably do if he somehow bought a new West Coast. I feel like Lex would probably do that plan, but he wouldn't be the guy who would launch the nuke. He would hire a guy who would set a network to launch the nuke. But again,
exactly. I'm couldn't be traced back to him. Yeah.
Exactly. But again, I'm getting ahead. I'm thinking too modern now. And,
all right. Last big thing. Well, actually, it's like the last 2 points on my list. But I'm gonna combine them, which is the time travel.
Okay.
So
the elephant.
I don't
in the
know.
Room.
Yeah, I don't know. Like the lesson meant to be learned, because Superman is told over and over again, like you can't fuck with human history.
It is forbidden to interfere
it is forbidden.
With human.
He literally tells him it is forbidden.
Kept repeating it over.
Marlon
and
Brando
over and
comes into the like his face appears in the clouds, Mufasa style, and tells him, "You can't do this. It's bad."
Yes.
And then he's like, "Fuck you, Dad," and he does it anyway.
I want Lois. Fuck you. It's like, and this is before we know that there's like a thing. We never know what happens between like Superman and Lois. There's never confirmed there's a thing between those two in this movie. So we don't know if that's.
Well, they're into each other.
I mean,
you can.
I mean, we know that they're into each other, and we know through comic books and of course through the lore that they do end up together. We know that, but in context, we didn't. It's like, wow, you're gonna turn back the clock for this woman you just sort of met now, and he did it for her.
He did it for like an expressly, I guess, selfish reason. It's because he wants to save the woman he loves, so he turns back all of time. But there are literally no consequences for this.
Yes, and there are questions too.
This creates a whole bunch of paradoxes.
Yeah, it's because first of all, okay, if you travel back in time, then where's past Superman? And then second of all, you turn back in time, but it looks like everything went back to normal. But it looks like Lois is like just comes back up and now is alive. How? And then also Jimmy was there, wasn't he in the dam? Also. Also, what happened to the other
people
nukes?
What happened to the nukes? People are in places that they shouldn't be in if the nukes didn't go off.
Yeah, and you're absolutely right. Usually, when you interfere with time travel, things get like you did something wrong. You broke the natural order. Things,
yeah, like this is like 70% of Barry Allen's character is just like fucking around in time and dealing with the consequences.
That's so funny. That's actually hilarious, actually. Like, if Barry Allen notices, like, wait, you could just do that and nothing could go wrong?
Wait, nothing happens? Wait, go.
It's like, no, too far back. We're going to come do it for, like, a few hours, like a few days, like, because that's apparently how Superman does it. Because, first of all, how does that even work? Moving the planet so fast reverses the orbit. That
the yellow
how
sun.
How does that travel back in like my head? you clearly are feeling my head being split right now. Like that doesn't work. It doesn't work. And if it does work, then tell me. Scientists, not nerds. Scientists, tell me how does if somehow the orbit gets reversed.
I mean, like,
what
does
it happen?
The DeLorean work?
Science magic.
How does Stargate work? How does Turok work? It's all either witchcraft or science.
I know, but I'm curious what would happen if the world or like orbit gets reversed. What would happen? That's my question. Actually, that's a question I actually do want to know.
I think we would all die in
because
a cataclysmic seismic event.
Yes, because
like everything would be shifting underneath like the crust.
Yeah,
and
so everything
like earthquakes, volcanoes, tidal waves, it'd be real bad.
So that's what's supposed to happen in the movie, but in the end, but somehow he just somehow traveled back in time. So that's
we've been over this. It's science magic.
Again, my head's being boggled as I speak right now through this concept of that it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way.
The thing that really bothers me, though, about the end of this movie is that, Richard Donner was working on this movie and most of the next movie, like, back to back. I think they wanted to film part one and part two at the same time, but they ran out of money and they needed to put something into theaters. So they knew where this was going. So why didn't they set up the second movie? Like, I know, like, half of it is filmed by someone else, and there's probably studio meddling, but it just seems like this is, like, prime opportunity to have the consequences of this time travel and Lois being alive, and then roll it into the next movie.
Okay, I mean, you're right. You're absolutely right, because you're right. Like, if this was two movie splits, I mean, if this was one big movie, but then cut in two, they should have, like, found a way to do that. But again, this was the first movie, so maybe they weren't thinking that far ahead. They weren't even sure if this was going to be successful. Remember, this was a nightmare of a production, if I remember correctly.
It was a nightmare of a production, yes.
Yeah, so they must have thought, okay, guys, we're not, like, let's just cut our fucking losses, let's just put the movie up, let's see where it goes. And then the movie was a fucking massive hit. So it was like, oh god, let's make the second one. Like,
Fired Richard Donner.
And they fired Richard Donner because they screwed him over, because he's a good, like, even though he was a good director, they said, nope, he was the one at fault, because everybody blamed him for this. Even though, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, that's usually what producers do.
Even though, if I remember correctly, it was the studio meddling. Yeah. Yes.
It's usually always the studio meddling.
That's my guess, though. I could be wrong. Like, I don't know the actual story. I know there's a documentary. I know that somebody's going to post that documentary on the comments. But what I do know is that it wasn't some... That's my best guess at why. And then when they put it together, I think they just wanted to make a new movie. And
probably.
Or the director. And since it was a new director, maybe he's just like, I don't want any of his... Like, I'll take his parts, but I'm like, doing it my way or something. Like, that's probably my guess. I don't know. I really don't know. Again.
We could have looked into it, but I didn't want to.
Yeah, too much work. I mean, we're really Bluffs, not the Bluffs. Like, you want the professionals. The professionals, guys. like we're giving you the half-assed, like, what... Like, you know, we know slightly more than you do, but we're not better than you because of that.
Exactly. Speaking of movie Bluffs, if you guys could like and subscribe, that'd be great. We need to remember to say things like that earlier.
Yes.
So people will do before they leave the video.
Please like, subscribe, follow us on our future Patreon that will exist one day.
Yeah, I think that's good for us.
Yeah. That's it for the first one?
Yep, that's it for Superman 1.
Alright.
Thanks for joining us, guys. If you stuck around this long, we'll see you next time.
Thank you.